I'm here today with Tim and Andrew, the men behind Man vs. Snake. How you doing, guys?
We're doing good.
Good. Thanks for having us.
Thanks for taking time out of what looks like it's already been a very eventful Kickstarter campaign. I know how much time they can take. How do you feel about it so far?
We feel like it's going pretty well. You know, we had a good weekend, and we had a, you know, one fellow from England come in and give us a big donation, which really lifted our spirits and put smiles on our faces. So we're really appreciative of that. And you know, we're at about 37 or 38% with 25 days left, so we're feeling pretty confident. You know, tentatively confident. I've never done one of these things, so it's new.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's important to keep the word out. Someone made an analogy. It's sort of like watering a plant. You need to keep watering it every day and tend to your audience and just keep the word up just so you just don't plateau.
Yeah, I mean, everyone we've talked to, you know, we know some other folks that have done it, and they said it's real time-consuming, and it is. It's like a full-time job just spreading the word and answering people's questions and emails and responding to things. So, you know, what we really want to be doing is just working on finishing the film, but this is a necessary process for us to get, you know, the funding we need to do it right. So I guess it's worth it.
Well, how did you guys first come across, this whole, you know, Nibbler marathoning thing in the first place? I mean, it's not exactly what you'd call a household name as far as these arcade classics go, but, you guys chronicled it, you know, for quite some time and now you're turning this into a film. So, What brought you to it in the first place?
Yeah, well, the way we discovered Nibbler was we were working on a show called Battlestar Galactica. We're editors, and we're working out at Universal Studios. And as a way to kind of kill time during late night editing sessions, we hauled a MAME cabinet, which, for those that don't know, it's a way to emulate classic arcade games. And it had a list of about 3,000 games in the machine. And so we're kind of working our way through the list and challenging each other to new titles. And one day we just stumbled upon Nibbler.
Yeah, I'd never heard of it. And I played it, and I wasn't very good at it, so I hated it right away. and Andy kept saying, let's play again. And so it got really competitive, and I must say it was pretty addicting. And I was trying to find a way to beat Andy, so I looked online to find out if there were any cheat sheets or strategies, and that's when we came across the original poster for Tim McVeigh Day for scoring history's 1 billion points.
Yeah, I mean, the kind of interesting thing about Nibbler, for those who haven't played the game, is that it starts off very slow and very manageable, and then very quickly starts to ramp up in speed and difficulty, and you know, your first game, you're not going to do well, but you have this feeling that if you can get the patterns down and if you can control the snake, then, you know, that you could get a lot further. And so we were topping out at maybe like 75,000. I think we got to like broke 100,000 mark. And that's when Tim brought in this poster, and we both our jaws hit the floor when we saw like some guy had scored 1 billion points on it. We just couldn't believe that it was true. And we did a little more research online. We found the original magazine article that had been written about it and some other news items about it. So we thought, oh, God, this is some guy really did this. And then on top of it, we found it quite entertaining that his name was Tim McVeigh. Like, we just thought that was kind of crazy because of the Oklahoma City guy. But, you know, so, you know, we didn't really think much of it. But at the time, Tim and I had been toying with writing a screenplay about the classic arcade gaming culture of the 1980s. You know, Tim and I are both in our 40s, and we grew up during that time, and we obviously loved games. You know, we had that thing, and so we were looking for a good story to tell within that subculture, or you know, from that period, and we thought that this would be an excellent one to do. So by way of trying to collect information for that, we started to call the Tim McVeighs in Iowa to see if we could actually find the Tim McVeigh. And we got a lot of hang up down Tim through Walter. Walter Day was the owner of Twin Galaxies, where Tim set the record.
Yeah, Walter was a lot easier to find. And we had heard that, you know, there was this movie Chasing Ghosts that was coming out, but it wasn't released forever. But we saw him on the web, and we reached out, and he said, well, let me reach out to Tim. I haven't spoken to him in years. I think he's somewhere in Oskaloosa, Iowa. And I said, hey, do you mind if we, you know, fly on out and just interview you, just do a little standalone interview? And I think we're just planning on making just a really short piece on this sort of historical, you know, kind of oddity of classic arcade gaming culture. And so we just went there.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that caught my imagination was the idea of a teenage kid walking into an arcade, putting one quarter in a machine, and then playing for about 2 days straight. Through the night, the arcade owner locked him in the arcade, came back the next morning, he was still playing, and his friends keeping him company and cheering him on. It just seemed to me to be a really inspirational and fun story, and that was what we were going to cover. That's what we were going to document. We were going to make a little video about that and collect some interview information. And then what happened was we returned from that trip, and bear in mind, a lot of people, have commented to us, why are you making this movie? They already made King of Kong and that sort of thing. We started tracking this story before King of Kong and Chasing Ghosts were released, so it kind of, our interest in the story predates those movies. But, and we think it's an equally excellent story to tell, and one that has deep roots, in the original classic, the original era of the classic games, the golden age of video games. So, But the documentary really took off when Tim said, "Hey, I want to go for this record again and see if I can get it." And we thought, well, that's going to be hard. He's in his 40s. He's no longer a teenager. He's got a full-time job. He can't just stay up all night, days on end. He's married. Maybe his wife's going to have something. But so we thought that would be a really interesting story to tell. Just to follow him on this journey as he's trying to do this, whether he succeeded or failed. And just sort of see what happened. And then after that, a bunch of other things happened, which were really exciting.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, there was some other interest. There's another player that we discovered, Dwayne Richard, who also, I think at the time we weren't aware, but he made a couple of marathon attempts maybe a couple of years back. And I think with this interest in us following Tim, he thought, well, wouldn't it be fun to really do a head-to-head competition? And something that we had never really heard being done, two cabinets, and it's because it's such an endurance event, it's almost like a race. These two going head to head. So we thought, well, if that can happen, we would love to certainly cover that and see what that would be like. And then we thought, well, then that will clearly be the end of the movie.
Right. We thought, okay, yeah, these guys are going to go head to head. One of them's either going to get it or both or neither or whatever. But, we'll follow them over the 2 days that they're trying to go for this record, and that'll be it, But then what happened was, one of the inciting, things, one of the motivations for Tim to go for this record again was the fact that there was a rumor of a higher score than his original score that came out of Italy, that was kind of rumored and disputed and unverified and various things. And we were able to track down the truth behind that score and meet the Italian player who actually did it, Enrico Zanetti. So that was a very exciting thing, the fact that there was another guy in another country that had heard of Tim by way of a video game magazine. Because, remember, this is before the internet, right? Today people can get on right away, instantly, and share their news, share their record. But back then, it would have to land up in a magazine, and that magazine would have to make its way to Italy, and then some kid would have to read it and go, "What? This guy said a billion points." So, we thought that was a really cool aspect of the story, and the fact that there was this international component. Now we had, Tim McVeigh, who's an American, Enrico Zanetti, who's Italian, Dwayne Richard, who's Canadian, and they all share this interest in the game,
and also Thomas Aki, who was actually the first pioneer Nibbler player too, and we tracked him down. And he was the one who discovered that if you played long enough for 2 days, you could get a billion points on a game. And he had come down from Bozeman, Montana, where he was attending college. And back then you had to get a record in person at Twin Galaxies. So he hitchhiked his way down to Ottumwa, Iowa, to Twin Galaxies. Set up a Nibbler game, and that's where Tim first discovered it, watching Thomas Aki doing what turned out to be a failed marathon attack.
It does sound like you guys fell into a far more interesting story than it seems like you originally anticipated. And to me, it gets even more interesting now. I'm looking at the rewards. I saw the poster pop up the other day, and it was stunning to me to see that Don Bluth had had drawn the poster and you know, several different pictures, I guess you could say, of the principal players in this whole thing. How did that come about?
Yeah, well, you know, we it's interesting. We one of the reasons we're on Kickstarter is because we want to try to raise some money to do to cover certain aspects of the story where we don't have archival footage. So we thought a great way to do it would be to animate those sequences to show, you know, to show the events through animation rather than just have people talk about them. And so, you know, one of the, you know, I mean, Don Bluth is sort of, you know, legendary within the world of gaming and in the world of animation because of his work on Dragon Slayer and Space Ace. So we thought, wow, how great would it be, you know, just joking between ourselves, how great would it be, you know, to get Don to animate these sequences? We didn't know if Don was still alive. We didn't know how old he was. We didn't know anything. So we just kind of put it in the back of our minds. And then, you know, when we started thinking about trying to put together a Kickstarter campaign and realizing that, you know, it would be great to have an image that really represented the movie and something fun and something related to video gaming, we kind of came back to this idea. And so I went online and just, you know, started poking around to see, you know, is Don Bluth still around? You know, he's got a Facebook page. Okay, that's interesting. Oh, he's got this animation academy down in Arizona. And so we just reached out to him through email and said we're doing this project. We shared a description of the project with him and some other information. And he said, yeah, sure. This sounds really fun. I love games. It seems like a great project. We're really happy to get his support. And so what he did was he said, send me a trailer or send me some video clips or photos or whatever you got, and I'll do some character studies of the different players, which is what those sketches are, and then he worked out a design for the poster. It was really exciting.
Now, continuing with the whole thing with the rewards, another thing that jumped out to me, of course, I like the little miniature cabinet, but the thing that got me, kind of perked my curiosity up to the point where it's probably going to end up being the reward I picked myself, is whose idea was the Walter Day bobblehead?
Yeah, that was sort of our idea. You know, it just, again, came out of our love for Walter, you know, the idea that how awesome would it be to have a little Walter Day in your gaming room, you know, overseeing your competitions. You know, he's such a positive force. You know, the guy, he's obviously legendary within the world of gaming, but, you know, if you get to know him personally, he's a really warm guy and just nice, you know. And so for us, it was just like, let's have a little Walter, you know, talisman that we can have in our game room. And
yeah, I think at first we started along the lines of Walter Day action figure hero, but the bobblehead idea kind of lent itself more to that.
Yeah, we sort of, exactly. We thought, actually, that's right. The first thought was an action hero, but that's a little bit more involved in terms of design and production and all that kind of stuff. And we found that producing a bobblehead was a little easier. So, but actually, we think it's probably a better perk than an action figure.
And I thought that was very unique. I think the whole project is very exciting because we've had a lot of arcade documentaries over the years. And as sounds like you guys have well noted since you've been, you know, since this whole predated King of Kong, and yet since then you've watched one after another, but it seems like they all kind of cover the same people and parts of the same stories. And so it was exciting to see some of the other original arcade champs, not just in a story finally or in a documentary finally of their own, but they're still active, but that there's still something actively going on in the modern day. Even the King of Kong, you know, you, with Steve Wiebe, you kind of had like the newcomer to the scene, so to speak, versus the old, you know, the old pro. You didn't have like this where you had two people that they were relevant then in the arcade scene. They're relevant now in that same arcade scene, kind of going at it with this big gap of time in between. And so I very much look forward to seeing this, and I'm very happy that the Kickstarter is going so well so far. for those that are probably listening to this, maybe while they work or they're supposed to be working, give them a little audio cue on where they can find the Kickstarter project and get in on some of those rewards. Maybe get a Walter bobblehead of their own.
Yeah, well, there's two ways. You can go to our website, which is www.manversussnake.com. So that's manvssnake.com. And there's a link there directly to our Kickstarter. Or you can just go to Kickstarter.com itself and just search for Man vs. Snake. We're actually, we were a staff pick. I don't know if we still are. So
that was yesterday.
That was yesterday. So if we line up being on the front page, you'll find us there. Otherwise, just do a search for Man vs. Snake and we'll turn up. We welcome all donations. We're excited to have everybody join us and be part of this film. It's really fun. There's a lot of surprises within the documentary. We didn't want to give anything really away in the trailer. And we think that if we can finish it the way we want to finish it, it's going to be a really great, fun, inspirational story for people that don't even know anything about arcade, you know, classic arcade games, but just want to watch a bunch of really fun, crazy characters going for their dreams, you know.
All right, guys. Well, I thank you for your time. Let you get back to promoting this Kickstarter. And look forward to seeing you. Thanks for you. Thank you very much, guys.
Thanks, Scott.
Thanks, Scott.
Take care.
Take care.